some of the leaves, foliage, and the trees. So with watercolors, and I'll start maybe with some very easy leaves using the Preziosa set, which is something that we never used so far. So it's a watercolor set with metallic paints, and there are 18 colors of different shades, and they're all based on this glimmering kind of mica. So it's a watercolor with mica, and it creates this beautiful shimmering kind of pearlized sort of metallic effect. So it's not real metals, just to make sure that no one should expect that these are metals, but they're very shimmery, and they are non-toxic as well, so you can see here as well. And the set is called Prezioso because it's all this preciousness of the metals, and that's why I also named them after beautiful metals and minerals. There are silver, yellow gold, antique gold, bronze, copper, pink quartz, cinnabar, pink aqua, rainbow quartz. This is the longest name, but it's really amazing kind of purple, pink, golden type of color. That on white it shows quite purple, this one, but if you apply it on the black paper, it changes the color. It's more like a very beautiful kind of pink. Antique brass, then gold, pink gold, rusted iron, pyrite, oxidized copper, blue topaz, steel, stibnite, and zinc. So these are all the colors that took quite a lot of time also to map them, because of the interesting kind of colors that exist in nature. And my father, he was a geologist, and since childhood I had this memory that we had all these kind of little ores and mineral kind of pieces in his cabinet, in his office, and it was really beautiful, and it looked like some sort of geological kind of museum exposition. But I really loved it, and it was really fascinating. My parents didn't allow us to touch it, but I always wanted to touch it, and I don't know, after some time it just disappeared. Maybe they donated or something happened to it, but it's a memory from my childhood, really, and that's why I also wanted to give this kind of as a memory of my father, and that's why it's precious to me as well. So that's a little bit of history about this watercolor set, and I hope that you'll enjoy it as well. So without further ado, let's start.
Just a quick heads up,
Harda,
we are having engaging people already on YouTube today as well.
Oh wow, so
So
cool.
I just wanted to
Oh, that's
remind
great.
also them that please feel free to add your comments, because we are here, we'll check them.
Yeah, Beatrice is
So
helping me, so she just goes back and forth between two cameras, and it's really, without her I cannot answer the questions, frankly speaking, but she reads the comments, and
yeah, we already got positive feedback about. Thank you for sharing your memories and such a special story.
Yes, thank you. No, for me every product has its own kind of story, and during these lives I really want to tell this story, because I don't know, unfortunately I don't tell it so well probably in writing, but that's also something that we're going to work on, because every product is very special, and it has a lot of kind of personal thinking, personal touch. It has lots of stories to tell you as well. So that's why we'll also create some blog posts. So if you are not subscribed to our email list, please subscribe, because we don't bombard you with just promotions, but mostly with some kind of useful materials and tutorials and announcements. Of course, there are promotions as well, some discounts or giveaways as well. So for beginning, I want to show you these two books that I, it's also a part of my life, so these streams that I want to share with you some of the literature that I use and I find it very useful. So there is this little guide to leaves, and if you are, you love the nature, and it's also something that comes from my father, probably, yes, because he was a geologist and he was very close to nature, my mom as well. Both of them, they were bringing us to the botanical gardens when since we were children, and they were showing which tree blooms at which time, what are the properties. My father, he was also creating some herbal medicines, so he had this kind of interest because it was more like a traditional kind of things that he was doing, and we were drinking all this kind of herbs since we were children. And I really like, you know, just to go around and to see the nature, look at the leaves, and recognize which plant is it and what kind of symbolic meaning there is with the medicinal or some other kind of properties they have, and really try to tell also to my children as well. Yeah, so we can try to, and in this book I found it in some bookshop when we were just like working in Richmond, I think, yeah. And I really loved it because it's quite simple book that is, it's not too much detailed, but it has the leaves, and it explains what is the name and habitat, and where you can find this kind of trees. So we can try to make a few of these trees, so painting them with our Prezioso watercolors. So and then I want to show you it will be some kind of textures, creating textures in watercolors. This is very beautiful book. It's an old book, so I bought it second hand because I couldn't find it new. So it's by a very talented artist, Kathy Johnson. So I have a few books by Kathy Johnson, and she explains how to create the textures and do art journals, and so it's really, really nice book. So it's not very old, but it's 1992, so it was published in 92, and you can see that there are lots of different textures, and including the foliage and tree bark. So we'll do a bit of foliage today. So it's here, but this will be second part of the tutorial today. So you can probably find this book at the library as well. So let's start. Unfortunately, I don't have the watercolor paper in black, but I'm going to use this. It's a drawing paper, and it's 200 GSM, so I think that it should be fine. So I have it, I was using it for some for pastels, but I'm sure that it can be used for watercolors as well. So let me see.
The name of the book again, the second one, I believe. But anyway, we'll share at the end of the live, we'll put all the details.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So the name of the book, it's Creating Textures in Watercolor by Kathy Johnson. But Beatrice will take a photo as well, and you can find it on Instagram, in Instagram post later as well. Or we'll also put it underneath as a comment, so I don't know what you're going to do.
Both on Instagram. Definitely YouTube in the description, and Instagram as well.
We'll add it. So don't worry, we're putting all this kind of bibliography. Yeah. My mom, she was bibliographer, so that's why we always cite the and Beatrice's mom is a teacher, so we cite the our sources properly. So let's start. So we'll start with sycamore, sycamore leaf, and it's very, very beautiful. And we'll do very much simplified, and that's why I like also this book. So it's called The Little Guide to Leaves, because it's quite simplified, and especially for beginners, it's easier just to see the shapes in simplified version. So we'll do it here. We'll start probably with some bright green. So it's called, I call it pyrite. You can call it yellow green. So at the end, it's there are five sort of branches of the leaf, and then and you can just do it like this, very simple kind of shape. So you can paint together with me, or you can do it later using the leaves from your garden or from the park. So collect some leaves and try to create leaves that you found yourself. And now let's add a bit of more color. So I'm mixing in the same way like here. So one side more brighter green, and another side is will be darker green.
Spring with smart today, yes, exactly. Yes. And also they are saying they're excited to see the result on black paper.
Yeah, it's really fascinating because it will brighten up as well. So on the, I think it should be a bit longer. And wider, yeah. So just try to make these brush strokes that sort of repeat the shape. So I just go in towards the center.
Wow, so many comments about black paper and the beautiful contrast that you are creating.
You know, if you don't have black paper, you can also take some watercolor primer, watercolor ground, and mix it with black acrylic paint. And if you don't have this watercolor primer ground, then if you want, I can show you how to make it yourself. So, because I know that there are some big brands like Daniel Smith, for example. I have one from Daniel Smith. They make it, but you can also create it yourself. So now I need to put red. So please let me know if you're interested in such kind of DIY projects. I like it. I like all these DIYs. I like making things. And
yeah, some of them say it's just hard to get watercolor to show up on black for me, they say.
No, it will show up because right now...
No, it's for them, they say. For them it's hard to get the color to really show up.
Ah, really? So you should try ours, maybe. No, I'm not salesy, but but it really quite thick, and you can see that I'm not taking too much kind of I'm not picking up so much paint because that's the way how I usually do. So now I'll take the smaller brush and I'll just try to make this kind of veins sort of the leaf. For that one I think I'll need to pick more, just so that it would really make some more contrast. So you can see it. So here it goes, the yellow. So it's basically gold. Or you can also use this antique gold. Let's use both of them. So like this. Don't make it too wet like me. Because here you need really to make the paint quite thick. And now let's make this tiny veins. Probably like this. Like so. It's quite beautiful, I think. Don't know what you think, but to me I really enjoy it. You can also alternate it with maybe a bit of silver. So it will make even more kind of contrast.
And someone is saying yes to the acrylic, black acrylic paint for the background.
Mm-hmm.
To share.
So do they use black acrylic?
No, if they are asking if you could share, because you were asking, would you like me to show how I do?
No, I'll not show it now because I can do it next time probably then, if you want. So this is a sycamore, so I'll just write it like this. It's not perfect, but it's quite pretty, I think. So let's call it sycamore.
You're welcome.
Can make a little shape of sycamore here as well. And next one, we can pick something else. We can pick. Don't this silver maple?
I like the silver maple.
Yeah, there is a horse chestnut. We can just do first few of them, just to make it easy. So the silver maple, you can see that it's probably from the same family, because it has the same kind of a leaf shape, and it's from the same kind of family, I think. Yeah, family name is Sapindaceae. I'm not so good in all these Latin names. So for that one, we'll use again this stibnit. So and let's make it very quick. So we just need to make the six main veins, and then paint it around that. So for
Close up. I can move a bit this camera down. And also, if you follow us on Instagram, because this is a comment from YouTube, we'll also post all of the pictures, so there you can really see the details, even better than from a video. So we highly recommend checking Instagram after this live, tomorrow, ideally. But let's see if we can adjust the camera a bit down.
I also need to So I don't really do the drawings because I feel like I don't need to make it too much perfect, and it's easier for you if you'll be trying to achieve more kind of more precision, or not precision, I'd say, just to enjoy it the way how it comes out, because it's not a portrait. So of course if you're painting a portrait of a tree and you really want it to be exactly the same, better probably to do some sketches first and then do a painting. But in general, I feel like this is some kind of fun exercise, and just go with it, go how you do it directly with the brush. And this is also something that many artists they do. They make the painting, or they make the drawing directly with the brush, so not to mark too many kind of, not too much, not to create too many marks on the paper, on the canvas. So this way it will be quite fresh and quick. So here I'm just almost coloring it with this kind of towards the center again, and I think it's quite interesting. So this size can make it slightly lighter because I added another shade of green. So you just making sort of hatching, as it would be on the leaf. Yeah. And that's it, I think. Looks a bit like marijuana, but I think it's not. So this is a silver maple. Let's call it silver maple. It's more silver maple. So as you can see, it's also quite good. These paints, they're good for some sort of calligraphy and for decorative writing. So you can also make such kind of art journal on the black using this metallic paints, and also combining it with gouache or some pastels. So all these opaque, sort of opaque or semi-opaque paints, and our watercolor, it's not exactly opaque, but because of this shimmering kind of mica, it just like reflects the light quite a lot. Now let's do horse chestnut, which is again from the similar kind of family tree. It has again this five leaves, sort of in one leaf. Don't know how is it called, that's why this leaf, it's quite interesting. So let's use this rusted iron again. So after that we can go for some other kind of plants. So they all have the center of the leaf, and from the center goes this five, it's like a star. So now let's use the larger brush again, so we can use bronze. So this is more kind of for autumn version of this plant, horse chestnut. And I really love it. So it's really like a fun. If you have some particular leaf in mind, please let me know. Probably everybody loves eucalyptus.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we can do
eucalyptus. But the colors with eucalyptus, yeah.
So after this, we can do some more kind of freehand kind of the colors of the more popular leaves. So what I'm doing is just you can also just use one one brush or go over it with some contrasting color, maybe. Let's use some blue. Although it's not blue, I just want to use blue anyway. I'll make a mess again. But it's so fun. It's really very beautiful. Look at this shimmer. So you can see here already that it's drying to much brighter kind of color. Yeah. So let's can go like this, just show the veins of the leaves. Really very relaxing. It's more decorative, of course, style, but you can make postcards and so let's call it horse chestnut. You can also put starting from the from the center, just go all the way out like this, and I'm not I'm leaving the sides because on the top they will be always a bit brighter ones, so the needles, I mean. Although these are not exactly needles, so they're quite soft. So if you go quite fast, it will be much better. It's easier. So let's go ahead. It's quite a pleasant exercise to do. For this fern, you can also use our detailing brushes, fine line, because it's all this kind of fine details. They're really perfect for that brush set. I always forget to take it out. Actually, I have it there if it's open. Maybe we can use it for the textures of the tree. Brushes but it's always good to have many different brushes for it's also good to check what kind of brush strokes you can create with which brushes, because this way you can always be quite versatile. So,
and we have an article for watercolors, brush strokes in watercolors, should be out this week on the blog.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So as I was telling you, so some new leaves at the very tips, because it's more like a spring version. So not them here as well, here and there, and this is more green. So if you keep going like this, you can make this fern look quite full. Can see it.
Yeah.
I think it's quite nice.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, if you feel a bit lazy, you can use just one color. It's really up to you. If you want to make it more kind of more interesting, you can also add a little bit of deeper green as well, like the the roots of the fern. So let me add a little bit of some mix of red and green, just to go over. Okay. I think it's quite cool.
Oh yes, you know, I always pick a favorite at the end of the session, and this is my favorite so far.
Okay. So I'll just more red name here. Asparagus.
Oh yes, also someone else said this is my favorite so far.
Asparagus fern. Looks like a palm leaf, but it's fine. Let's put some green in the middle, so it'll be much cooler.
So let us know if you have any preferences for the last one. Otherwise, I think we mentioned the eucalyptus.
Yeah. So you can also just like add some little details from the same leaf around, or just create this chestnut as well. Let's go for I don't know, let's do this palm maybe. It's quite nice.
Let's do a palm.
So just let me know, maybe I'll do other few kind of leaves. And then I'll move to the normal paper, not the black one. So for the palm tree, you really need some brush like this. So it's a rigger, but this rigger I should take a proper rigger probably. I always take that it was shorter. It was old kind of version. So for the palm tree, you just need to create this long stem that is much thicker at the bottom, and then maybe just you start from very fine and then just make some kind of little push. So yeah, let's load a bit. Okay. So the very very soft the sleeves and still quite strong. So I really need to show this. I think I'll just move it a bit like this. And towards the bottom they become thicker. So the sleeves still are used for weaving as well. So trees are still quite important in many countries, I think. So
I love how Ardak makes it so simple.
It's really simple. So you just pick the brush and...
Hold on, maybe we lost the connection here. Few seconds. Okay, we're back, Ardak. Okay. We're commenting on one of your comments. I love how Ardak makes it look so simple.
It's very, very simple. Please, just enjoy yourself. I think it's the most important kind of technique here is to start very fine and then push it. And pull it up. See it? So just like, so this is the movement. So you just like press a bit on the brush like this and then pull it up. So it's just like, now let's add a bit of darker kind of. And for that I'm using steel, so it's really a steel color, and it's quite beautiful. And for that I'm doing the opposite, so from the middle to towards the ends, because I want to use only partially. So this way, really make this create this beautiful effect of mixing colors. It's quite beautiful. And, can you see that it shimmers quite a lot? I really love this kind of effect, that it really shimmers.
Yeah, you can definitely see it.
So I can use one more kind of little blue of the blue topaz. The blue topaz was a very special as well for me, because it was the... It's not exactly the same, of course, because I'm making them more kind of decorative, so it looks more like feathers of peacock now. So. Yeah, when I was young, my brother, who passed away already, so he gave me very nice, beautiful ring. It was Bluetooth pass. That's why I wanted to add it here, because it's really such a beautiful kind of rare topaz, because usually topaz it's yellow, but blue topaz it's even more special for me, so you can see it here. So let's call it here Pearl Palm. Oh, we can, yeah, let's write it with this blue, probably blue color. So we can write it. Oh, it's really amazing, this blue. Really hope that you love it, because it's quite special for me. So I can put it like this. Little heart. So beautiful.
Nice.
I think this is my favorite so far.
I think yes. I think I changed my mind.
So.
A new favorite.
I think it's even more beautiful when it's wet.
Maybe.
So let's go ahead now. And so you can really just like take any book that you have, maybe some magazine from your. Of course, better to do it from nature, but just in case if you'll be doing it during the winter or you don't have this kind of exotic plants in your region, so just take some magazines, especially they have a lot of beautiful pictures, and they always just show some nature, and there you can really just like do it, take some inspiration from there. And in particular, if you have a garden center or some other kind of place where they have these catalogs, you can also take this catalog and get lots of beautiful photography from there as well. So now let's go ahead and I think I can just that's okay. So I want to show you some kind of trick that I would use for this papyrus. So you don't need to use brushes for this kind of plants that are with such kind of longer sort of needles. You would need some sort of palette knife, or if you don't have palette knife, you can also use the plastic card. So, because plastic cards, they have very nice kind of wood size. So, especially if it's a plastic card that you don't use, you don't need to throw it away. It can be used for your art. So, we're very much promoting also this recycling, upcycling things, because especially of plastic, so you don't need to throw away things, but you can also give them second life, especially at the time of I don't know. So you can really use it. So for this you would need some kind of palette. So I don't have this palette right now, so I would just put some kind of paint with my brush on the palette knife, so it's also can be used like that. So I'll use this pyrite green, which is, so I'll use this side. And just go like this. To reload my knife, so. It's easier if you just load it from the from some wider palette, but just showing something that I didn't plan to do. So you can do it like this, a bit longer stroke. So I'll probably use this palette knife also. Thin kind of lines can really achieve with this just a palette knife.
Wow, that's super cool.
I'm not doing it properly, but you just need to practice, because you don't really plan to do it. It just comes to me, these ideas. So in comparison, if you do it with a brush, you can use, of course, these miniature brushes, but you can also use brush, of course, the lines will be a bit more kind of soft and maybe more precise, but I think it's quite cool as well to do, to use different tools. So you can also use different hands, so you can train your left hand and the opposite. So if you're left-handed, try to do it also sometimes with the right hand. So it's something that could be interesting, you know, in general, for you to do. So I'm right-handed, and you can see that I'm very bad with my left hand. But it's one of the exercises that I was doing at some classes, and it was very interesting, because really. So this is the papyrus. Now let's add a bit of this yellow gold at the bottom.
Again, this temperature issue.
I should change the battery, I think.
We are still on YouTube, but they were just saying amazing technique, thank you for the tip. They loved it, really.
Oh, that's good. Well, sorry for this, because really need to change the battery.
But it's okay, we have the YouTube. And now we'll, as soon as people will reconnect.
Okay. Yeah, that's good to have two channels at the same time. So be just using this and some brown chips on them, on the leaves. A bit of green here is also. So I think it's quite cool.
Love it.
Papyrus.
I think we can look back here. It's still a bit hot, but at least it's working.
Yeah, remove the
thank
So this is eucalyptus, but of course we'll do something more. So eucalyptus has this more kind of rounds of leaves, and for that we'll use normal round brush. So, number 9, and it has more kind of cool color, so that's why I'll mix this oxidized copper green together with steel blue. This is really probably eucalyptus color. So as all our aspiring artists, so let's put this kind of leaf, eucalyptus leaf.
We are back on Instagram.
Yeah, sorry for disconnecting. So this is very much simple kind of eucalyptus leaves. I don't know. It looks like eucalyptus. So what I do, I just do it like this, and then I should practice a bit more probably, but to me it looks like eucalyptus. So
okay, you're back. Everyone is back. Thank you for staying with us.
Thank you.
You didn't miss too much anyway, so don't worry.
Yeah, so for eucalyptus I was just mixing green with steel blue to make it more kind of cool green color, and can add one more stem. So for eucalyptus you just make it round shape leaves, sort of round. So one and two. Sometimes they are put a bit more kind of with the side, they show themselves. Like this. Yeah, so this is very simple eucalyptus. Don't think that it looks like eucalyptus so much, but we can also put some little veins just to make it more look similar. But I'll buy eucalyptus, the real plant, and I'll try to do it more kind of from life, because I don't remember so well how eucalyptus looks like right now, so, frankly speaking. So we can use some little kind of stems like this. But this is more like a decorative eucalyptus. Yeah. Don't judge me too much, because I'm not... don't have eucalyptus right now.
No, it's only positive feedback.
Thank you. Thank you for being with us, and sorry for this technical issues with my phone.
Just if you see we're not here anymore, jump on YouTube and vice versa. If you don't see the YouTube stream anymore, you can find us on Instagram.
So this is very much decorative eucalyptus, of course. But I'll do more kind of detailed one, more real look more like a real kind of eucalyptus separately. We now buy real eucalyptus.
We have this this friend of ours. She's been going from YouTube to Instagram and now back. But she's been following us. So Papyrus is her favorite. I think it's the will you be saving this live? Yes, we save all of the lives on our channels.
So I'll write that it's eucalyptus. So. Eucalyptus. And now I'll just show you some kind of just loose leaves that they're just like normal leaves probably, or some kind of decorative what you can do with. So it's quite simple kind of thing. So you can use different different colors as well. So if you want to make leaves just for some kind of wreaths or some other kind of decorations. So it's again the same kind of principle like I was showing you before. So you just press it a bit and then lift it up. So this way you can do it with different colors, or you can also make a some kind of two color, bicolor kind of leaves as well. So I can use something like that. You can just can alternate some larger leaves with smaller leaves as well. So don't forget to load the brush a bit with the paint. So really just need to play a bit with it and see which effect you want to achieve. But that's the simplest kind of leaf shape that there is. And let's use some other colors as well. I just want to show you so you can this color, for example, it's a pink quartz, but on the black paper it will look more whitish. So I'll also add a little bit of cinnabar just to add a bit more kind of even more pinkish kind of color, and I'm mixing them. You can just add a bit of color while it's the paint is still wet. So the all this wet and wet, they still work here. So you can, let's use other color. So this is this pink Aura Rainbow Quartz, and we can just add here something with the smaller round leaves, for example. So you can see with just one brush you can do quite a lot of different leaves. And this one of my favorite colors really, this pink Aura Rainbow Quartz, and you can see that it's very, very pretty. So maybe just two of them intermingling on two sides.
Also, they are interested in your rigger brush, I think.
Yeah, I really like it. You can see it. Yeah. It's actually even longer and more kind of easy to use the one that comes with in a set. So this brush, it's much smaller. So you'll get a better one. Thank you. So it was good, but I wanted to make it even more, even better, really, in the final kind of product. This was still just like a product I was still designing it. Strange kind of tropical leaf. It came to me. So there are some kind of large leaves that have different colors. And they fold into each other. So we can also do some kind of becoming boring for you, no?
No.
Shall we go to, shall we move to?
But I think, yeah, we've been live for 1 hour now.
Yeah. So you can really just do a lot of different leaves with these brushes, and not brushes, but with these paints. And even the black one, for example, I can show you. It's really amazing. So these are just loose leaves that you can play with. And if you try your brushes, you can really do leaves and flowers, because that's the easiest kind of brush stroke with the leaf. And usually when you try your brushes, you can also do this, it's an exercise that you can just like, for calligraphy is also just, I didn't spread this paint, sorry. So just to see how from which thickness you can get. So this is the typical kind of way of checking your brushes, what kind of shapes they can, and how they can come back to its shape. So want. And of course it's basic seaweeds. So you can make seaweeds like that. So thick towards the end and very thin. Seaweeds weaving to according to the water currents. So you can see that when it's dry, it's much brighter. And I wish that you will try it first with different kind of just playful subjects, and you can also combine it together with gouache or with some other kind of with just normal watercolors. You can just put the accents with the metallic paints. And now we can move probably to I wanted to do ginkgo actually, but it's okay.
It's okay,
we'll do it next time.
So while we're going to the other topic, let me share a few feedback here. So first is a positive one saying, I'm gonna share this live because you really deserve more people to join.
Oh, thank you.
And they were asking about yourself, if someone taught you how to paint. What is your background?
My background is, I don't know, I was lucky enough to be born in the, I don't know, during the Soviet times probably, because I remember that even at, in my nursery, we had a very good, at least it's probably me as well, I just really feel like I was very lucky, because at the nursery we had very good teacher who was teaching us how to draw. She was even putting some kind of vases, she was saying, let's draw this room. So she was teaching us how to draw from kind of like a child, from the fantasy, of course, so you do lots of free topics, but she was also explaining some kind of basic rules, how to do shading, how to do kind of, you know, drawing and painting, how to mix the colors. We did some folk kind of drawings, paintings, and it was quite a lot of stuff, and we were illustrating the favorite book. I remember that I made this Cipollino kind of, so it was Gianni Rodari's story about Cipollino. It was more socialistic kind of story, so that's why it was in Soviet time quite popular for children. And so it was a lot of this kind of input since the childhood at the nursery. Then at home, of course, my parents, they were always very much pro kind of creativity. We had lots of paints at home, and they were buying all this kind of felt pens that they were quite novelty at that time. So we had these pencils. My father, he was engineer by his education, so he was showing how to sharpen the pencils. So maybe this kind of things as well helped as well, because we had lots of pencils at home. I don't know, it's just a lot of different inputs. And at school as well, we had a very good teacher. She was a real artist, and in Soviet times, for example, and still in this, all these countries that came out from the Soviet Union, so in Kazakhstan in particular, we had this pedagogical faculty at the art schools. So we had teachers who were teaching art that they really studied at art schools as well. So that's why our teacher, she was really, it was one of my favorite lessons, and I really loved it. So she liked me too, probably. And also we had this technical drawing. So there were all these subjects that I really loved. And I remember since childhood, I wanted to be an artist, and maybe that also helped. So I was reading a lot about artists. My mom was bringing lots of books from the library, so it was... also during the normal subjects like biology, for example, geography. During biology, we had to draw the this kind of amoebas or the cycle of the of how the frog comes from the little kind of, how's it called, these little tadpoles. Tadpole, yeah. So sure. All these kind of things, I loved drawing them. So my biology book was, my biology journal was full of nice drawings. My cat draw this kind of anatomy journal is also album. So I was doing all these kind of things for other people. Yeah, at the university, at school as well. My classmates, they were asking me to draw their portraits as well. So I was sitting just drawing them in this graduation albums as well. So I drew lots of them, I think. Yeah. So it just was quite natural. And then later at the British Council as well, when I was working, it was my first full-time job. I was very much in this kind of art community as well, because British Council was promoting art and education, culture of Britain abroad. So I was really just like quite lucky, I think. My parents, they had lots of musicians and artists as friends. So it was all the environment probably, yeah, and the time. Maybe it's just something that I really loved, and that's why it was all coming to me. Yeah, thank you for question, and sorry for such long answer.
No, I think you could also talk while you show your things.
Oh, yeah.
It's really nice.
I usually talk.
That's a backstory.
Yeah.
Also, here we have some friends saying, I'm looking at your brushes right now and paints. I just recently purchased some of your brushes and I'm starting to use them.
Mm-hmm.
The paints and the leaves you are sharing, they are both super beautiful.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. No, I don't do it so much. I'll be honest. So it's just like I'm doing it now with you for the first time, because I don't usually do this kind of leaves so much. But it's cool kind of topic, and many people, they really love it. So I'll do it a bit more probably. So I really love to do it from the real kind of things, but when I don't see it, my imagination is not so great. I don't know how eucalyptus really looks like. I remember in general, but it's always easier to when you see the real kind of the real. I'm much more familiar with the oak trees, with other kind of more. Less exotic for me, probably, trees. Yeah. So, but it's always quite interesting, and just try to look around and to observe the nature, especially the colors of the nature. It's really so beautiful. One of my art teachers, he was very interesting. He told me, Armat, he told me that artists, they have a different kind of vision. So they shouldn't look just straight like normal people, just like focused on something. No, the artist should look very much unfocused. So they should absorb everything around them, surroundings. They should be very much open-minded, open-eyed, I would say. Yeah, so he was saying, look around and think, how would I paint this? How would I draw this? Which colors would I use, for example? So it's just like, you go around, you don't paint, you don't draw, but still, your brain just like already training itself to see things, to see the light, the shadow. Just go around, look at the tonal kind of values. So look at the colors during different time of the day. That's what I felt very useful from his advice. So it was really interesting. So the artists, they are not only working when they paint, but even when they don't paint, they also already working for something in the future. So it's this observation kind of so now let's start painting the foliage. So I'm using now the book of Kathy Johnson, and it's really beautiful book that I bought used, and it's creating textures in watercolors, how to paint 83 textures from glass to fur. So it's really cool. So this foliage, it's there are different kind of techniques, and that's why I want to show just like maybe on one, yeah, maybe for example this tree here, and then I'll go for other kind of, yeah, very very nice, look at this, so really cool. And there are different trees, so we'll try to do all of this. Let's try. So I'm using my Sirena watercolors 24 half pans, because it has much more kind of greens and browns and blues here, although there are some reds as well, so reds and yellows, but of course there will be lots of green here. So you can use the green directly from here, or you can just mix it as well. And I need this because it's quite difficult to see. So also for beginner artists, I would suggest to color this first, and also to color to try it on different papers that you're going to use, just to see what are the colors and how do they behave on different watercolor paper. And this exercise can also be this kind of study. So first, foliage scumbling, it's we'll just use two tones or three tones, I don't know. So just like we'll use maybe this. Yeah, so I'll make a smaller kind of section of this. So I'll add different greens. And some yellow, of course, on top of there. Some more yellow here. So on top there is always more kind of stronger stronger green, and at the bottom there is more kind of darker green, if you see it very simplistically, so because all the darkest kind of shade of the leaves to go down. So and here, so you just let it dry. That's why I want to do something else on the side. And so this is the first kind of layer of my wash, and I just mix different colors. So that's what I did now. Let's do foliage wet and wet, and this is probably more interesting for me because I don't like to do it. So here it's more like autumnal kind of colors, and let's use the same colors just to see the result, how. You should have wet it, okay. Let's wet it orange. So this is the wet on wet. Should have done it on wet. Okay. So this is wet, and now I'm adding. So let's add more kind of some magenta. That's orange I already added. Let me just make it soft, this kind of borders, without too much of this orange. So I'll put more clean water. Yeah. So now let's add more kind of, let's put some blue amber as well. By using more kind of, I can use a little bit of yellow just to mix the blue in, and some blue, maybe some from marimba, it is so. Just put any colors that you like, because at the end it's quite loose and very much sort of abstract way of painting the foliage. Let's add some more cobalt purples. It's really cool. Yeah, add a bit of depth. Maybe you can put some paint gray. Just be a bit more. More brave. And this, I don't know, my colors are completely different. I don't know what I'm doing, but so let's put a bit more kind of depth with this ultramarine colors, so I think to look much better this way. So the lighter colors again on the top and the darker colors at the bottom. So let's keep it like this. I don't know, maybe some orange. I think it's nice as well, but make some regular shape as well. Let's add a bit of water. Let's keep it dry. Let it dry. This is with the natural sponge. I'll show you a slightly different way. So it will be quite similar, but because I didn't prepare natural sponge, I'll do it with a spray. So that's another kind of technique, but it's not here. So for the natural sponge, you just do it with a natural sponge like this. I want to replicate similar effect with a spray. So you can do it, for example, you take this yellow again. So yellow, maybe with some yellow ochre. So you do it like this. Just very much roughly you put these colors, but very quickly. So add a bit of green here, maybe a bit of green. So the paint should be quite wet. Don't let it dry.
So a bit of. By the way, Adak, they are loving the colors you chose, especially for the second one, the wet and wet.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Thank you. That it's a mess. I thought, my goodness, yeah. And now, this is the most important part. So just like, do this spraying. So it's quite cool kind of, especially good on a larger kind of, on a larger paper, not like here. I'm doing it because I'm trying just to put too many things in one on one page, but it's really very very cool kind of thing. And here, this is super wet, I would say. Yeah. So just let it dry like this. While it's still drying, you can do it. You can do what a scratching kind of thing again. So just like, so you can. It's called graffito, and actually many artists, they use it. And one of our friend Valentina, she uses it as well.
She was here before.
Ah, really?
Line. Yeah.
Okay, so she uses as well, and Beatrice can share her. So you see this. This green, this dark green, for example, or light green as well, you can accentuate it. So because you're scratching the paper, the this kind of darker, it will darken and the pigment will go inside quite a lot. So it's really, really cool kind of technique. And just be careful, don't scratch it too much. It depends on what kind of paper do you use. Try, of course, how does it scratch. And just see, yeah, because I'm just trying to finish this paper that I had. I'm a little bit thrifty person, so I like to finish what I have till the end. Just use it till the end, so that's why I'm still using this paper. It's good paper, so I just want to show you that even on such kind of paper, it can come out quite interesting. Nice, you see? All this dark kind of effect. And it's super wet. If you want, you can do it as well here. You can see as well. So all this. If you don't want to wait for this kind of, to add this kind of darker lines of the stems, you can also scratch them and create this kind of effect while it's still wet. And you can also alternate it with the thicker kind of scratches, or some kind of different textures, like, I don't know, like some kind of the bottom that there could be some thicker lines, I don't know. Right now I'm just doing something for fun, but if you want to be more kind of precise, try to look also to what kind of shapes do they usually have. So it's usually not so straight, so that's why with the palette knife it will be even easier to create this natural kind of lines.
Because you used it already a few times, Ardak, where can they find our palette knife?
Ah, okay, sorry. No, I don't mention it.
Because we have new friends as well, so maybe they don't know exactly
it's a secret,
which brush comes from which collection.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I should mention it, of course. So, this this kind of pumps with our larger brush sets, it's our Turner collection for watercolor and Renoir collection for oil. But it's exactly the same kind of palette knife, and they're very, very useful because I like the shape, that it's quite small. It's very easy to paint with it for oil and acrylic. And for watercolor, it's very useful as well because you can do this kind of scratching kind of graffiti kind of technique easily. And so you can see it. Yeah, you can also just like tilt it a bit and let the paint go in the directions that you want it to go. Some artists, they also paint on the tilting and or tilted surface. I don't do it because I'm just trying to do it for the video. So I'll also write down the names of these techniques. So this is how to say it, it's very much kind of, it's spraying, yeah? This pen is super thin, it's 0.05, so it's too thin probably to see it.
There's this one here.
Ah, yes, thank you. So it's spraying. Spraying, this is white and white.
Yes, cool. Also, they love the palette knife tip.
Ah, thank you. And this is scumbling. Let's finish this scumbling because it's dry now. Scumbling. So we can finish scumbling. So scumbling is basically layering. So you just add more kind of... I would say it could be darker paints or at the bottom especially. And some of the... So this kind of technique can be used for many different subjects. So it's also a little bit of dark blue and at the very bottom indigo. Now I can add pale gray together with draw amber, just at the very bottom. Yeah, just scumbling, it's really very much chaotic kind of brush strokes that will replicate a bit more kind of natural natural texture. And here again you can easily use the same kind of technique if you want, or so because it's wet right now you can scratch and add a bit of some of the, so if you want otherwise. So with the what I like of this technique that it uses the paint that you already have on paper, so it doesn't add anything new, but uses, utilizes what you have, and it looks quite natural as well. And it's very easy. Yeah, this is the, these are the more like shape of the bushes, but the same you can apply to the and of course let's use while it's more or less wet, we'll add a bit of leaves, so we can add quite dark leaves. Some colorful leaves as well. And leaves we already saw that you can just touch the paint with, touch it with this kind of round brush. So it's some orange as well, like. So we have this purple and blue here, so orange will look quite nice. I think looks quite similar to Kathy's result, and I really like it. So maybe you don't need to do it too much like me, but just give some sort of suggestion of this. Yes, but even like this it's nice as well. And here as well you can just add a bit of last probably deepest kind of colors. cannot purple, just to make it even more kind of sort of almost black here. If you want, you can use larger strokes and yeah, it looks great. Looks quite good. What do you think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And this spraying, of course, I scratch too much, but it's okay. It's should really. Yes, so this white and red.
One more.
Mm-hmm. So let's do these three shrubs.
So, Doug, if you could send again.
Are you sure?
We'll just send it to the other channel.
Mm-hmm. So for doing this shrub, for example, you can first start with the warm sepia and do do this kind of some of the stems. Or you can do it on top. I want to try it the opposite way from what she did, from Katie. So it's just adding more kind of, because I like it dry slightly on top of the paper. So I'll do it more like a wet and dry technique as well, so just wanted to show you. So looks quite nice already, and if you want, you can add little highlights as well, just not highlights, maybe just some brighter color. Some shadows as well. Okay. So let's add a bit of water for more kind of area look, and then I think I like it good. So now this domestic shrub is quite nice. For that one, we'll use large round brush. And I'm mixing chromium oxide with rose sienna. So I just let's make this beautiful shape of this domestic shrub that is more kind of perfect shape. Here you can really use this crumbling kind of technique, or you can also use wet and wet. So here you should this texture. And definitely this is with some kind of elements of scowling. And while it's drying a bit, so I can maybe add a bit more. Anything. No, I'm doing making a mess, but it's okay. So now we can also just make some winter shrubs. So of the these are shrubs, and sometimes they have the fruits as well. So let's use this warm sepia. Can be also mix a little bit with paint gray, and here we can just maybe a bit of violet, just a little bit of warmth. And some marshmallow. So during the winter, they lose all the leaves, maybe have just few leaves on. Only some dry fruits. So that's what we're trying to show with different tonality. Just want to add some stems to there are some paints that they have granulation, and that's what you can see. It's quite, sometimes it's interesting to observe it. Let's add a little bit of depth here.
I'm following from here.
Okay. That's what they're doing. She's watching something else.
Looks good.
Oh, I think that's enough. So just don't forget some masses and volumes. So, for example, think about this as masses of kind of shapes, that larger shapes, and create this. Volume here, so it will be more shadow on this side and at the very bottom. And you shouldn't forget about it, so from both sides.
From the video, you cannot really tell what is the book and what is your painting.
Oh, really? Oh, I can tell.
No, I mean, it's
No, but you can really. Try different different techniques. If you're interested, we can continue, and we can also try to do something outside as well, maybe in the park. So just showing some little kind of sitting outside in the park. What you can do, what can you see, and how can you just like try to paint it as a sketch. So I'll also write here, so this is winter shrub. So winter shrubs, they have only stems, so bare branches, yes, and some fruits, if any. There are sometimes very dry leaves or dry something, I don't know. So this is domestic shrubs. The domestic shrubs, of course, they have this kind of special kind of shape that people really just like train it or cut it. And this is a wild shrub. It has all this irregular kind of shape, and of course you should show the volumes. So I think that will be it for today, and please let us know if you enjoyed it, if you like such kind of format, and you can also suggest which topic you'd like to see. So if you to follow my tutorials based on books that I have, you can also put this hashtags art with Ardak. We'll be very happy to see your artworks as well. And I want to show again this book. It's by Kathy Johnson. So it's Creating Textures in Watercolor. It's really very nice book that we can use also for some other textures, because it has lots of different textures, and I feel like it's easy to follow as well. She has very good kind of explanations. So there are water textures, foliage, tree bark, earth, pebbles and sand, rocks, grasses and weeds, weathered wood, lichen and moss, flowers, fruits and vegetables, fur, hair, so skin tones and textures, glass and metal, rust, and all different kind of textures of the forest, of seashells, fungi, laces, and everything else. Even basket weaves. Wow. So it's all this kind of old tractor. Well, I really like it.
So you can see. Just from the audience. They loved today's sessions.
Look at this. Uh-huh.
Especially the pine tree, they say. And wet on wet. Mm. Very inspiring, thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. And I hope that we'll see you next time as well. Please don't be shy. Tell which kind of, I don't know, subjects you would like to see again, and not again, but next time. Yes, and of course we'll be coming back to some to the most popular subjects like trees and the flowers, for example, or some other kind of later as well. But we'll also announce all the topic for the next stream. And yes, and thank you for being with us. Bye bye.